disadvantage to begin doing some of the planning, okay? And the more I reflect on that, the more I see the wisdom in that, okay? So you've got a store coordinator right away, okay? And see, the thing is, people who aren't working have time. They have what we don't have, okay? And we made some mistakes by doing too much, and we had a volunteer run the store, and all of a sudden the volunteer left, and we were stuck because we couldn't handle it anymore. But now we've got patrons running the store, and there's an assistant store coordinator, and the store coordinator's not there, and the assistant takes over. So it's incremental. Okay, if you try to do the whole program, and I mean, we've spent 3 years getting to where we are. Okay, and we started out without any conception of it becoming as it is now. It's a general idea that the direction we want people to have control and make decisions. But it's one step at a time. And you stop and look at, okay, here we are now. Now what do we do? Okay, and it's a human process. Okay, so you're tapping into resources that have never been tapped before. Okay, it's like finding a new oil well. Okay, I mean it's there. There are resources and skills that you won't believe these people have. Okay, that are just can be extremely well hidden. Okay. And you find that resource and you go with it. Okay, so you might wind up in this direction here because you've got a person who can do this. Okay, whereas another program might be going off in this direction because they've got a person who can do this. Okay, we just had a new patron walk in last week, and he says, "Well, I don't have any skills at all. The only thing I can do is sell things and talk to people." Whoa! We've been waiting for you for 2 years. Okay. You just take what you've got, okay, and you work with it. And you don't have any illusions of doing a great and wonderful job. You do the job that's needed that day, and you're open about your mistakes. And a real critical moment early in the program, I think I mentioned yesterday, was when I really blew something, and I really made a stupid mistake. And somebody called me on it, okay? Junior stood up and said, "You're wrong. You just said this, and now you said this. You're wrong, and I caught you." Okay, and the only thing I could say was, "You're right, thanks. I forgot that. And you're right, that didn't fit. I made a mistake." Okay, that's what every single person there has done some time in their life, and that I do on a fairly regular basis, okay, is to make mistakes. Okay, so if you're open about that, and we're open, okay, here we go back again. All of this ties together. We're open about our own limitations. I don't have the answers to this. Okay? I said a number of times, we've never done a hard times cafe before. Okay, we don't know how to do this. You think I'm an expert, I've never done this before either. You know much about it as I do. Okay, we're flying by the seat of our pants. Every program's going to need to have to do that. We have to be open about our limitations and work with what we've got. Okay? And we don't have a model program that the whole country can follow and set up step by step like we did. We're just taking it one step at a time, and that's what everyone else has to do. What we have is a basic philosophy that I think works, that we've shown can work. But everyone has to adjust it and adapt it to fit and to work with the resources they have. So if you have someone who's real charismatic and has a great sense of humor and you know, you can get Jay Leno to run your meetings, great. but if you've got Bob Dole running your meetings, well, we'll work with that. Okay? I guess he's got a sense of humor too. But, I mean, or George Bush, I don't know. Someone who's not really charismatic. You work with what you've got. And I think that those things can make it easier in one way or the other, but they also make it harder in another way. And one disadvantage of having Jay Leno run your meetings is people are going to be less likely to interrupt. So if you've got somebody real charismatic, you're going to have to struggle harder to keep people the perception that they have control and that it's up to them. Okay, I see three hands, one, two, and three. This is what we do at the meeting all the time. Count the hands. Okay. Yes.
I can see, being on the other side of the fence, your predicament that a lot of people that you are servicing may not have had what I see as assertiveness training. And these people, they don't know empowerment. They don't know any of this stuff. They've always been there to do this, and they've never been learned, never been taught, never been around people, positive people, that will give them the chance to be themselves. So it's a whole different thought process. And I think, in order for it to fly, if you're going to do it, you have to step down from your role in your office management. And even though you need an advisor who knows what the program is, maybe your position, but getting it together, you wouldn't be a controller. 3 years ago, when I was still involved with Head Start, I wanted to start a parent participation group. And my main goal of that was actually just for moms to get together, or dads to get, parents to get together and have a gripe session. Where do you take all these gripes, and who can help? Where would I go? And what they ended up doing was they took, I wish I had this program run, because they took my empowerment and our staff that was involved. They said, well, that's a great concept. My idea was no staff involved in this whatsoever. Take a parent who's been in the program that you can rely on that might be a controlling agent, but don't put a staff in there. When you put a staff in there, you've totally changed the atmosphere of control. And it's their program, not yours.
Right.
And till this day, the parent participation group is led by a staff. And they need this for the empowerment of the parent group.
The staff has to do some unlearning.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
You really have to unlearn some things that you were taught to be true. Okay? And in a sense, you have to go against the grain. Okay? I mean, the director of community mental health told me we could never sponsor a Hard Times Campaign or never have a program under our organization like this. Okay? And I believe he's right, because they've got auditors and levels of bureaucracy and control that they have to deal with. And even as a staff person, you have virtually no control. So probably within you're swimming upstream, and you need a very enlightened and flexible, basically you need an administrator. Let me just highlight this. Experts and co-learners is, I think, what she was saying, okay, is that instead of experts, we're co-learners. But there are no experts. And if anything, the experts are the patrons that we're working with. We opened 2 weeks after I called Greg and said, try something. Okay? And I came up with a name a week ahead of time and decided to serve a meal, and we just had a meeting. I didn't write the first grant until the following July. We got it in August, or October. We got it up. The first grant money we got was October after we opened the building. November 91, we got our first grant, and October 92.
So the first meeting you served as dinner.
Right.
Where did you get all the supplies? You just went out in the community yourself?
Gretchen, she's volunteer coordinator, so there was a cook who said she would really like to do some cooking for poor people if anyone ever opens a soup kitchen. So we called her, and we went to the local grocery store and we served chili, and we said, can you give us some beans and tomatoes and meat? And we said, well, maybe part of it. And the grocery store gave us the rest of it. And we bought some of it with our own money. And someone made some corn muffins, and we had dinner.
And then
basically, we begged for food. we got people to donate food. And, you know, she was able to get some commodities and things like that. And we had very creative cooks who were getting by at 30 cents a meal.
Now, your patrons, how did you reach out, tell these patrons this dinner was going to take place at this time?
We sent out a flyer. We just sent out a flyer to...
Where did you come up with these patrons' names? How did you know who to send to?
Oh, we had the general assistance list from the Department of Social Service. They were all on a list, and we just got a computer printout with mailing labels.
See, we have
mailing
so
labels.
Much of a confidentiality stuff.
That's why I think it has, like she said, it has... Not staff.
The way I would start it now, if I were to start it, you see,
right.
We had a crisis.
Right.
We had a crisis. All 300 of these people faced an immediate crisis. They lost their income, they got their last check, and we opened a week later. Okay? So in the same week that they got their last check, they got a flyer saying, come to the Hard Times Cafe, good times, good food, good people, let's see what we can do about this. okay, and that's basically all it was. I mean, you know, I cut and pasted together because I couldn't figure out how to use a computer program to make a nice, fancy flyer, so it's a cheap-looking flyer. And we just sent it out to people, and, you know, 24 people showed up. Next week we had 26, and, you know, it just kept on going. Yes?
So basically, with all the confidentiality even within our office, couldn't you, if you prepared your flyer, take it to these agencies, and they could address them themselves, and you're getting the difference?
Yeah. I would do it through personal recruitment right now. I think what we did in Battle Creek is what works. And, you know, we've got some things developed that you guys are welcome to take. I mean, you can, you know, call your program whatever you want. You can even just put a different name on it and copy our brochure if you want, but just hand it out to people, okay? And it says on every, just about every single page, that you have control, okay? And I think, see, that's what people don't have. Anyone who's receiving services doesn't have that sense of control, okay? So you're providing something that they're starving for, okay? And so I think getting people to come is not the challenge. The challenge is staying within this ourselves and building this into the program.
When Battle Creek was talking about first starting, Battle Creek got together with some of the Hard Times Cafe people, and we had like an idea session on how to get the word out for them. We came up with ideas like contact your local electric company. A lot of people are on budget incomes, and sometimes they make, you know, deals with the electric company. I'll pay you so much per week, and you'll keep my electric there. Sometimes the electric companies will throw something, some kind of a flyer in with their electric bills. That's a good way to get it out. There are soup kitchens that will hand out flyers to people who come to the soup kitchens. There are local stores who will put it up on the board, you know, just tack up a little flyer saying, you know, come join us, there's a free meal involved. Sometimes that alone gets them there, and then when they find out what it's all about, they keep coming for the information and for the comradeship, you know, being able to talk to people. Some people are shut-ins. Maybe a local home nursing program for people, you know, if the nursing program has to go to the home. Sometimes shut-ins don't get out except for maybe Hard Times Cafe. We have some right now that the only time they get out of their home all week long is when they come to Hard Times Cafe. We have the local volunteer services program. They contacted a lot of their volunteers. They're the ones who do the cooking for us. So we already had our volunteers set up for one day a week to do the cooking and the cleaning up. Some of the DSS staff does dishes for us because DSS closes down at 5 o'clock and we don't have to do dishes until 5 o'clock. So they come over from work, they do the dishes for us afterwards. It's not hard to get the word out, especially when they're looking for something.
In 6 hours, totally by myself in Battle Creek, 65 people came to the meeting. I mean, you know, it's not a big thing to get people there. I think that, and then word of mouth will help you when you get that. The question is responding to people as they come and keeping up with them, okay? And for that, you're going to need some volunteers, you're going to need some people who have some time, and you're going to need to take some risks, okay? There's a need for flexibility and humility and patience and faith, and so you hire a worksite coordinator and let them loose, okay? I mean, if it was an ideal world, you know, I would have someone available 2 or 3 hours a week for every coordinator to help them do problem solving and do their job better. They're lucky if they get 15 minutes. Any one coordinator is lucky if they get 15 minutes, and they're lucky if they get 5 minutes of my time. Okay? I mean, this is the reality that we work under. So we don't give our coordinators very much training at all. I mean, we are woefully inadequate in terms of preparing people for the jobs they're doing, but they're doing phenomenally well. Okay? I mean, they're handling it. You give them the responsibility, and they rise to the occasion. I would like to respond to Mary's question, because she was back early, and just kind of go through this to give you the large picture, and then let's open it up again to questions. So if we could get clarifying questions for the next hour. Do you people need to get up and move around for 5 minutes, or we got a little bit of a late start? How about if we, tell you what, let's, I think can't help you if you have to go to the restroom. Go back to the restroom. But let's do a little bit of exercise just to loosen you up and give you some balance from sitting. And this is something that will also be helpful to you. The conditions. The conditions that helps that to follow. Okay? So there's a resource there that is really hidden. Welcome. This is Gretchen. DSS volunteer coordinator, Gretchen Wilbur. She's my co-conspirator. We've been working together on this for just about almost exactly 3 years, because it's about this time that I called you back then. And Sharon Walter is an elder. She's our records coordinator. Been in the program a couple years. One of the people that patients really look up to a lot. Okay, the conditions for improvement. We talked about control, and we could spend the whole seminar, I think, just talking about control. That's absolutely a critical thing. And we've talked about acceptance a lot, but that's one of the conditions that has to be there. People don't feel accepted. And looking at conditions, you have to look at all of the little things that can communicate non-acceptance. If you have bulletproof glass, and someone that turns a little lever and picks the paper out, and you never have human contact, what is that communicating to the person who's standing in front of you? Okay, did you really accept them and trust them and get comfortable with them? Okay. Sitting across a desk from someone, standing behind a podium, what does that communicate in terms of acceptance? Acceptance means relationship. Okay. So it's the personal contact and making sure that everyone has their hand shaken by someone and is welcomed and feels comfortable and feels accepted. And in the process of serving the meal, giving them the feeling that they're at one of the best restaurants in town and that they're getting top-notch service. Okay? Helping them feel welcome, feel accepted, feel important. It's a critical condition. Because if you don't feel accepted, imagine going into a restaurant, okay, you walk in there for breakfast, and happened to be in the Soviet Union. I walked in and sat down. There were probably 60 tables in the restaurant. There were two other people there, and I waited 45 minutes for my service. Yeah. And the waiter came and tossed me the thing. It was no question that I was an American when I was speaking Russian, you know, no idea what I ordered. Just treated me, you know, I just got up and left. It was clear they didn't want to have anything to do with me, okay? I never went back to that restaurant again. I found another restaurant that I went to and ate at regularly, okay, where someone treated me and helped me to feel accepted, okay? It was clear these people did not like me. I was not going back there. If I went back to Russia now, I wouldn't go to the same restaurant, okay? Even if it's quite likely it's a totally different proprietor. You know, I look at that building, and, no, I don't want to go there. Okay. So imagine yourself. If you don't feel accepted, you're going to pull back. Okay? If to the extent you feel accepted, then you can grow. Then you can improve. Okay? Support. Real basic, simple, common sense things. Imagine where you would be right now if you didn't have any transportation or child support. How many are child care? How many of you would be here if you didn't have any transportation or child care today? Yeah. No. Okay. Transportation means someone to give you a ride, even if you're over somewhere. Okay. I mean, we all came from another city, so that takes care of it right there. Even within the same city, if you don't have transportation, if you don't have someone to watch your kid, you're stuck. It's not. They're very simple, basic things of support. We also need emotional support. Support that has no personal involvement. Okay, here's the keys to my car. You know, go or drive it.
Okay, where's it at?
Okay, but that has no personal involvement can serve to diminish rather than power. Okay, so it's more than just providing a handout or providing the same things. It's like, oh, Ernie, here's my car. Okay, take good care of it. Have a good trip. Okay, there's a difference with that. Back to these bottom steps. I never take one of these in isolation. Okay, we try to provide this through the Department of Social Services and a lot of other agencies. We try to provide means of support, but it's also support in terms of a personal relationship. Okay, and it's in the right doses. Okay, so if I say, okay, Ernie, here's my keys to my car, and I'll help you stand up, and I'll walk you to the door. Okay, now be careful, don't bump into the table there. Step right over here. Now put your foot, not there, put there, you're too close to the table. You might not, no. Okay, What does that communicate?
One of these days he's not going to get back.
So it's in the right doses, okay? And in order to do that, okay, there has to be some listening, some understanding, okay? You can't, again, do these in isolation, okay? So that and also emotional support, okay? And that's something that we never did anything to stimulate at the Hard Times Cafe. We never consciously said, what can we do to help people provide emotional support? Roxy.
That's one of the first things that we noticed when we started going to the meetings. When you go in and somebody will say, well, how are you today? You know it's not just an automatic question. It's something they're really concerned on how you're feeling. How is your life going now? It's a closeness. It's a family.
You feel it here. You just don't say it. You feel it here like somebody.
And we never did anything to stimulate that consciousness. That developed naturally on its own. You bring people together, you treat them with respect, you listen to them, you help them feel accepted, give them control, you help them feel accepted, you provide some basic support, that emotional support grows and blossoms on its own. Okay? And it reseeds itself. Every time someone is supported, it helps them to support someone else. Okay? And there's a sense that they're in this together and they stick together. Okay? If you're on a raft with five other people in the middle of the ocean, you can learn how to support each other. Okay? Either that or you're all going to die. Opportunity. It means having a good chance. Okay? Having, in a sense, a kind of a challenge, but also a chance to advance or to improve or to change something. Okay? And we're not structured to provide opportunities for disadvantaged people. Okay? Our society isn't structured for that. We want to tell them what to do. We want to control them. We want to force them. And we're moving more and more in that direction. Okay? But what can you do if you don't have that on your back? Is a real important question. It's like, what can you do? So opportunity without control or without feeling accepted, without basic support, can really have no meaning. But with those things, it becomes a whole new window that opens up. You know, like this room has no windows. And if all of a sudden we opened up this thing and was on a beautiful landscape, that's a sense of what an opportunity can give to you. It's got something to move toward, somewhere to go. Okay, it keeps you from feeling stuck. Okay, it gets you moving. You're not alone. You've got something to look forward to. You get away from the mindset of just what's this moment? How can I feel good right now? Okay, how can I pull someone's string to get control, or how can I get high so I feel good for a little while? Okay, those questions become less important because you say, "Ooh, I want to go there." And you've got something to move for. So there needs to be some way to provide an opportunity. And that doesn't mean you have a ton of resources. We had no resources and still don't. Okay? So the opportunity was to work, to provide community service, to help other people, to develop some skills and things like that. You work with what you got. Okay? If we have $1 million budget, we'll start a family opportunity center and create a whole range of opportunities that we don't have now. But even without any resources, you look at what are some opportunities. What's something, so I can't get an opportunity that's going to point way over there. What's an opportunity that's going to get me right up here? So I can look forward to that and say, hey, if I get there, I'm a lot closer to somewhere else. And I can move on in different directions. Okay, so it's a question of clarifying where that fits. There needs to be an incentive. Okay? Incentive is an interesting word. I'm real fascinated by the history of language and where words come from. And it comes from Latin. Incentus, which means to set the tune, like in music. Okay, someone will set the tone, you know, when you sing in the key of E or whatever you need to sing, whatever you would anyway. But it sets the tune. And it also comes from the word incantare, incite, actually comes from the word incantare, which means to put into motion. Okay? So incentive, okay, opportunity kind of wakes you up and gives you a sense that there's a direction. Incentive gets you moving, gets you started. Okay? It's a fuel and a catalyst for growing and improving. Now, incentive needs to be more immediate for someone who's more disadvantaged. Okay? And the more stuck you are, the more hurting you are, the more you need an immediate incentive. Okay? That's why we went down to Battle Creek. I suggested they run out and get some laundry soap and toilet paper and toothpaste and shampoo, and we had to store it the first night. Because, boom, there was an incentive, and everyone who had an idea at that meeting got some points, and just about all those points got turned in for stuff. And, like, four people went together and got a gallon thing of laundry soap, and they were the happiest people in Crown Creek, I think, that night, because they had clean clothes the next day. Okay, I mean, that's something that you can touch and feel. Okay, so the story is a real critical part of providing that. And of course, the whole hard times dollar economy evolved out of the need to provide some incentive. And again, we don't have the resources to adequately support. Okay? I mean, when our exchange rate was 13-1, people were still working to earn those points. Okay, they have meaning and they have value. Okay, and our exchange rate now is 4-1, and they're working at the same time. It's amazed me that hasn't been more of a drag on our program. The fluctuation exchange rate, when it gets stuck up at 6-1, people still work as hard as they do when it's 4-1 or 3-1. So you need a range of incentives. You need an immediate incentive, and you need some intermediate incentives, and you need some long-range incentives. Okay, and they keep you moving. Okay, if all you have is just immediate incentive, I'll move to here, and where do I go now? So you keep them moving, okay? So one incentive people see is a route to get a job. They see the community service work as a way to build up work habits and get some experience and get some referrals so they can get a job, okay? And you can see a job is moving into maybe going back to school or moving on to a career or something like that, getting some experience. We try to provide ranges of incentives. And the incentives need to be realistic, and they need to be possible, okay? And if you have the incentive without any sense of control, okay, I think you've lost a whole lot. I have a lot of experience in trying to undo the effects of token economies in trying to control people. And what they do is they provide incentives for people, and you get points or tokens or poker chips or pieces of paper or stars or any number of things. Most cases for not messing up. If you don't do something wrong, you get a star for the day. And if you do something wrong, you lose your star. And everyone who has 4 stars gets candy after dinner or something. It's a really common thing that they do all over the place. One place took it to an extreme, and they had three floors. It was a behavior treatment unit. And the first floor was the edible floor, and if you didn't mess up in 15 minutes, they gave you an M&M. And after you progressed from the edible floor, you moved to the social floor, and if you didn't mess up in 15 minutes, you got someone come up and say, good job, you're real perfect. And then they move on and check on your checklist and do that. I saw them wake someone up on the floor once and say, good job, you're real perfect. And then the third floor was a token floor, and you got a token, you got a poker chip. For every 15 minutes, you didn't mess up. And if you got 20 poker chips, you could lay on your bed for half an hour and listen to the radio. Totally undermines people's sense of control and acceptance. They have no input into that process. You know, it works short term. People figure out ways to beat the system or just say, hey, listen to your radio for half an hour, it's been worth it. Okay. I gotta pull your chain for a while. That's worth it. I've fantasized about that for a long time. So the incentive in isolation, and that's what I'm trying to get across the problem, is any of these in isolation lose their meaning. Okay, and say, well, we're going to do incentives, we're going to do a token economy, but I'm going to control it, and I'm going to set up all of the things, and I know what I'm going to do, and things like that. Okay. Now, our hope and our goal is for the incentives to become internal. Okay, that people help because they realize what they're gaining by helping other people. Okay, I think Ernie is a good example of someone who's really internalized a lot of incentives. One reason Ernie was hired as a partner is you can always depend on her. Want something done, Ernie will get it done. Okay, he'll figure out a way. If he says he's going to do something, you know he's going to do something. If he says he's going to be there, you know he's going to be there. Okay, and Ernie feels good helping people. Okay, and I think just about all of our patrons can say that. They feel good helping people. Okay, no one pays them for it, and in some ways they feel better doing that than they do earning hard times dollars. Okay, and there's been discussions. I proposed the thing because we weren't doing a real good job of welcoming new patrons for a while. People were getting into their own kind of groups and friends, and they hadn't seen each other for weeks, so they'd all be talking together around the same table, and new patrons would come in and feel isolated. Okay, so they weren't doing a good job for a couple of months there. I proposed an incentive system, you know, let's pay part times dollars for a welcoming committee whose job it will be to welcome them and things like that. And what came back to me on that was, no way. This is absurd. We don't want to be paid for welcoming people who can be friendly to people. We don't want to be paid for being human. That's demeaning. We want to welcome people because they need to be welcomed, because we need the program to grow. So new pets. Opportunity to earn incentive, they didn't want it. They wanted the internal incentive. So that's really our goal, is to develop those internal incentives. Responsibility. Also, I talked about, to some extent, it's one of the basic principles, but it's a condition that has to be there. Okay? Having no responsibility simply means it doesn't matter what you do. Responsibility is the ability to respond. Okay? Stretch the word a little bit, stick a couple letters in there. It gives you the ability to respond to any situation. So it means you experience the consequences of your action. Okay? So you can't protect someone from their own consequences. They're given the responsibility and it's up to them. And what we've discovered is most of the time people rise to their responsibility. Just about every single time. I can't think of a situation where someone hasn't risen to their responsibility. In order to give someone responsibility, we need to let go of it. Okay? When we made a decision to hire a coordinator, the first coordinator for a worksite coordinator, Gretchen and I let go of that job. Okay? And she took over. She did a much better job than I ever did. And told you yesterday, we had 6 work sites in a period of a month, and up until then, we only had 2 over a period of 9 months. Okay? But that means I'm not going to follow around and check up and say, okay, now what you do now? Call every time and do all of that. I can't control someone if I'm giving them responsibility. Okay? It means accepting the consequences of their decisions. Okay, and you find a balance with this. Okay, this is how this all interrelates. You find a balance with that because you have to get some feedback. Well, if you do this, you might have a potential problem because of this, so you might think about that. Okay? Tina had a great idea for a fundraising event that she wanted to do before Halloween, and I said, well, we've got 2 conferences coming up in the Haunted House. And remember how busy you were last year for the Haunted House and how busy you were in May for the conferences. Okay? So Tina adjusted the schedule. It's still a great idea, but we can do it next year and adjust our conferences so we can. Okay, so you have to find that balance, to give the feedback and to be clear, but still to give the responsibility. Okay? And ultimately, she could have said, oh, I'm going to do it anyway, and she could have got approval of the patrons and elders to do it, and she may have done a great job at it. My concern was that she'd been too stressed out and stretched too thin. Okay? I may have been wrong on that. Okay? But that's her responsibility. I'll give her the potential consequences. I didn't say don't do it. I said think about this. Okay? So the control is with the person to make the decision. Okay? The other thing is you want to match the responsibility with the ability. Okay? And you can often exceed what you think is the ability by a fair amount, but you don't want to. You want some balance there. You don't want to give someone responsibility for something that they're not ready for. Okay? I tried that last winter when we first lost our funding and I wasn't sure how long I was going to be able to stay with the program. I tried to give the elders responsibility for running the meeting. And that's something that you really need some training for, is what I learned. It's not something you can just naturally rise to the occasion for. And it became real clear when one of our elders, who was very well-spoken and good thinker and intelligent and just spoke up very well at meetings, had to run out and when she was reading the meeting and throw up because she was so nervous. Oh. It became clear to me that I had set her up for failure. I didn't know she was real nervous in front of people that she would tell me, and so she had a responsibility that was unfair. Okay. So this is learned that you really need someone who has experience as a presenter or a teacher or a therapist or someone who's comfortable with that, or at least willing to learn that, has some experience with that. And justice. Justice, I think, has gotten to be really distorted in many ways in this culture. We think of justice in many ways as getting even. Okay, the punishment fits the crime. Okay? In this context, I mean justice as staying even. Okay, that everyone has. has an equal opportunity. Okay? And what justice really means, if you look back to the biblical meaning of justice in the Old Testament, it meant having a right relationship with the community. And when they talk about justice in the Old Testament, that's what it means. Having a right relationship with God and with the community. Okay? And that's what we mean by justice here. Having that right relationship, a relationship that's fair, that's adequate. Okay? That you get what's coming to you in a positive way, as well as in a negative way. Okay? So we think you get a crime and someone goes to jail, that's justice. Okay? But you do a good job and you get what's coming to you as a result of that, and that's justice. Okay? And we've had patrons who have worked very hard and gotten full-time jobs almost. There's a place that will hire you up to 39 hours a week and never give you benefits and hardly ever give you a raise and call you in any time of the day or night when they want you to work. And if you don't show up, they can lay you off and hire someone else because there's a ton of people out there in Clark County who want a job. So if you don't like it, come on, quit. And I couldn't blame you. He'd come a long way. He worked there for a long time. He said, enough. I want to be treated like this anymore. Okay? Justice is missing and really interfered with this process of improvement. Okay? That's something that needs to be sustained. Okay? Justice sustains us. Okay? And it's different than charity. Okay? Charity makes us feel good. Oh, I helped this person out. Now look how good they are. They got a new coat and all this. Okay, they're nice and warm right now. Okay? Justice can make us uncomfortable because we have to look at ourselves. We have to look at what I have versus what someone else has who's working maybe just as hard or even harder than I am. Okay? It asks us uncomfortable questions about the values of our society and where we really place the dignity of the person in terms of our priorities. How important is that to us? Is that more important than having my garage door open? Okay, having this person be treated with dignity? It gets down to a real basic level, and we need to look at those priorities. Okay? It really forces us, if we continue to focus on that, to really look at the whole structure of our society and how things are working and what's happening. And to ask some questions about that. It makes us very uncomfortable. A good example of that is I read recently that the Federal Reserve, I guess last spring, they have a criteria that if unemployment drops below 6.5%, they automatically increase interest rates. That was the process last spring. They adjusted that figure. But they look at how many people are out of work as a potential negative thing. The unemployment goes down, and the stock market goes down. Okay, because people are afraid that we're going to have inflation, and that there's not enough people that are going to gain a middle wage or more wages in the economy. So there's a structural problem there. So basically what we're saying, for our economic comfort, we need a certain number of people to be unemployed so this business can lay people off if they don't put up with not getting any benefits or any raises or treating with respect. Okay, if there's too much of a demand for employers or for employees, for workers, then we can't sustain our economy the way it is. Okay. So there comes up some very serious and uncomfortable questions, and we continue to focus on this. Okay, pay attention to that. And I think ultimately, if you come from the ground up and work with those people, and you have a sense of solidarity and joined with people, that's how the system can change. It's the only way is from the bottom up. Okay, because to change it from the top, you need to be well-connected. That's just absolutely clear. If you've got $40 million, it's a good chance you can get elected to the Senate, or at least to Congress. That's what runs our culture now. And if you continue to work in this way, you're going to run into those questions. It's going to be important. If you want to be comfortable, don't get into a problem. Any questions on the conditions for improvement? We'll open it up to general questions about implementing this again once we've gotten through the last set of steps. We'll go through that before doing it. Any clarifying questions about what conditions? So this is part of the relationship because our relationship establishes those conditions, but it's bigger than that. Okay? This is all relationship theory. And somewhat this is going to be limited by the structure within which we work, but a lot of you can do pretty much this in any structure. This starts having some changes in the structure. So you may have, in an administration that won't allow participants to have any control. Okay? So that's a limit that you have to work with, and what kind of control can they have? They figure that out. Okay, what can we start with so they have some sense of control? Okay, how can you build that in within those limits? So this gets into systems. This gets into organizations. How do you structure that in? And each of these is structured as well as you can at this point into the Hard Times Cafe systems. Okay, so our whole system of decision making, our system, our economic system with the hard times dollars and points of improvement, the system for the coordinators and how the elders operate, all of this is structured into that. Okay? But without the relationship, that structure doesn't have much meaning. So you really need it. It's not like you can take a piece and say, well, hey, yeah, I'm about to do the support part. Controls on it. I'll just support and acceptance and opportunity and, yeah, I'll be patient. You know, I'll try to understand, but I don't want to listen. And respect, I don't deserve my respect. It's not going to work. Okay? This is it's a whole package. Okay? Take out any one block and you weaken the structure. Okay? If you take one of the bricks out of this hotel, you're going to weaken the structure. Okay? And if you have a storm, there's a likelihood it's going to crumble. If you take a brick out of a corner, okay, it's going to weaken even more. And I would say these are the four corners for the basic principles. You might still be able to accomplish something which is significant if you get it from other migrants. Okay. The process of improvement. How do people improve? Okay. What are the common denominators and what are the steps that people go through when they improve? From my experience, these are the seven steps. The most significant in those changes. Now, someone may start working first and then change their perceptions, but the bottom line is, from my experience, if someone doesn't change their perceptions, they don't make lasting improvement. Okay. And if they don't participate, they don't make lasting improvement. Okay. So each of these build on the other, and the bottom line is changing perceptions has to happen pretty early on in the process. Okay. The thing to really remember, and this is just my own belief, I can't give you any research to substantiate it, but in working with clients for 18 years, I'm convinced that improvement is simply an aspect of nature. Just like when I cut my hand, I got a big sliver the other day working on my house, and I can't even see where it is now, it's already healed up. Natural part of my body that knows how to heal itself and take care of that wound. And our psychological and emotional and social improvement, I think, is also a natural process if we don't get a whole bunch of stuff in the way. And it's just something that we learn to work with. Okay? If we try to force it, if we try to push it, it doesn't work. Okay? If I try to make that pet my cutter, whatever I try to do to it, I'm going to infect it or I'm going to irritate it, make it worse. Okay? You can't plant a flower and make it grow faster without weakening it. Give it a whole bunch of manure and it'll shoot up and die. Okay? It has to grow in its own time. It's part of nature. Okay? So this process, it can really give us a lot of confidence to see it as a natural process. It's not like you have to work against. You're not swimming upstream when you're working with helping someone to improve. Okay? You're going with the current. All you have to do is get some of the boulders out of the way. And maybe the dams in some of the So changing perceptions, and I've talked about this in a number of different ways, I think, throughout the 2 days. I talked about how our brain is structured and how we have these little rivers, okay, and that each of us can perceive something in a different way, a totally different situation. So if we perceive ourselves as stuck or hopeless, that becomes self-fulfilling. Okay, then we are stuck and we don't see any hope. And when we don't see any hope, we don't move. And when we don't move, we don't improve. Okay? So the perception starts it off. Okay? And that was what was clear in the first meeting that we had in the Hard Times Cafe. My intent and what I planned with Gretchen was to do a little stress management seminar. I've been teaching stress management for 15 years. you know, I figured, well, these people must be under a lot of stress and losing their income, so I'll do a little talk on stress management, kind of turn those, and we'll try to help people manage the stress of losing their general assistance. It took me a half hour of meeting people, and then when I spent some quiet time reflecting on what I was going to say, it was clear that that was not where they were at all. Stress was the least of their concerns. Where they were really needed to do was to change perceptions, okay? Because they saw themselves as big-time losers. The government had pulled the rug out from under them. They had no means of support. They had no way to pay their rent, no way to get gas for their car. There were no opportunities in terms of jobs. They were stuck and going nowhere. And so that first night, we talked about how you perceive things and how you can make decisions to perceive things in a different way, and that's what starts you moving. Okay? And changing those perceptions. So changing perceptions ultimately involves changing experience. You have to provide experiences that match those perceptions. Okay? So I can convince you that you have total control, but if the bottom line is if you say you want to do this and I say no, you have to do this, you've got to back it up with experience. Okay? If you can't see a way out, you never find a way out. Okay? You have to see it. Okay, and maybe you have to move a little closer to it, and now I can see it, okay? So what I'm saying is some of these others may happen first, but this has to happen. That's why it's on the bottom. It isn't necessarily the first step. Although, frankly, from my experience, it's just what I've learned in counseling. You start it right away. And one of the things that I do with the men is focus on strengths. Okay? The first session, I make sure, even though they forced me to do an evaluation and a bunch of paperwork the first time I see someone, I make sure that I found at least one strength in the person. Okay? And everyone has a strength. And as you get more experience looking for them, they become easier to find. So a woman comes in and is really hopeless and stuck in her relationship. Her husband totally controls her, and she has no job skills, and he's now leaving her for a younger woman, and she's totally depressed and has no resources and no money. What's she going to do? I'm going to listen to that closely, and one of the first things I'll say is, you have an incredible amount of endurance. You can put up with all kinds of things and still keep going and still survive. And you know, that's going to be really the key to working through this. Because you're going to have to endure a lot, and it's going to be a long haul. But you know, you can have the confidence that you can do it, because if you put up with all of this, okay, you can certainly endure what it takes to get you back on your feet. Okay? So to find that strength within them, okay, and everyone has it. Okay, that's our challenge, is to find that and to help them see it. Okay? And that's where we're coming from right up here, is focusing on that potential and not on the deficits. And that's why we've turned down money that required us to ask people to prove how bad off they are. Early on, we could have got some consistent funding that would have kept our exchange rate very nice, but we would have had to have people prove to them how bad off they are and consistently confirm that, and we said no. Because that undermines someone's dignity. This month undermines our focus. If every month you have to prove to us how bad off you are, then it's taking our focus away, taking those perceptions away from what your potential is, and that's what we're doing. That's what we're trying to do. The other thing is, it's harder to change perceptions when you're in isolation. Okay, because your perceptions will continually confirm themselves. Okay? So as you're building community, again, this interrelationship, as you're building community, it becomes easier because you see other people changing. Okay? Ernie can see how much Sharon's improved. Sharon can see how much Dwayne's improved. Ernie can see how much Roxy's improved. Okay? It builds on itself. Okay? So it becomes harder to hold on to those perceptions as you see other people who are in as difficult a situation as you are making those changes and moving on. We also have to change our perceptions, okay? That's part of openness and becoming an effective helper. The helper has to change the perception, okay? If I'm perceiving someone as their category, which is paranoid schizophrenic, I am missing their essential humanity. I may need to give them the category because the agency requires me to come up with a diagnosis, but I'm going to let go of that right away. Okay? Because all that does is give me a set of symptoms that I can expect, and I need to deal with this person as a person. And to the extent I'm perceiving them according to their diagnosis first, I'm diminishing them. I'm missing out on their strengths because the diagnosis is based on weaknesses. And so I have to change my perceptions and let go of my habits and let go of my preconceptions so I can demonstrate the confidence that these people really deserve. And that's not an easy thing. I'm not saying just change your, snap your fingers and say, oh, okay, I'm going to see you as this way. No, it's a constant thing, and often the best way to learn it is in hindsight. Okay, I really was looking at this person and thinking, wow, you're really crazy. And that was pretty dumb on my part. You know, looking at this, this did not work. We talked for 20 minutes, and this just simply did not work. And what was I thinking about? How was I seeing you? Okay, and that's the way you can learn a lot of this in terms of hindsight. So you back up with the hindsight and you go to the ABCs, accept, balance, clarify. Okay, I was in a hurry, I was worn out, and I wanted to get this done. And that threw me out of balance. So I wasn't relating to her human to human. Okay, I got back into my professional role and was relating to her as a schizophrenic. Okay, so it's something we gradually improve. Okay, and we can be open about that. And you know, the last time I talked to you, I don't think I was very sensitive to where you were coming from. I was in a hurry, and I was trying to get some stuff done, and I think I missed what you really were saying. Okay. In order to do that, there's openness and there's humility. So these things all, the only way I can put them up on the board is to keep them separate, but they all intermix. And I'm trying to figure out a way to make like a wooden model where they all kind of intersert together. There's a model somewhere. So these all intersect and fit with each other. Okay. Any questions about changing perceptions? Won't change the perception that's worked for 12 years. That's not within my power. Participate. To participate means to take part or to share. Okay? It means being actively involved versus being a passive recipient. And you don't participate in a movie. You sit back and you watch the movie. And you don't participate in a play unless you're on stage and you have a role. Okay? And the only way you can participate in an empowerment process is if you have a role. So we participate when we're involved in the planning, when we have responsibility, and when we feel a sense of belonging. A participant is not someone who goes along with what's been said by someone else. A participant is someone who has a part. They take part and they are a part and they have a role. And it gives us a sense of investment and a sense of responsibility. When we participate, what we do matters. Okay, we matter. We become a part of something that's bigger than us. Okay? We get moving, we learn, we draw on other people's energy, we give other people's energy, we improve. Okay? Without being able to participate, nothing happens. We can't improve passively. This sense. And you can't take an audience and say, I'm going to prove all to you people, no matter who you are or how you're doing it. Okay? It just doesn't happen. Okay, they have to take a role, they have to take participate. The most significant means of learning is through experience. Okay? I have a rototiller and I have a manual that tells me how to adjust the belt when it comes loose. And it becomes loose, you know, every few months or so. And I have to get out this manual and I follow through step by step how to adjust the belt. And every time I was getting frustrated because every time the belt would squeak, I'd have to get out this manual and read the steps. And I couldn't figure out, you know, I mean, I built a house. I mean, how can I not figure out how to adjust the belt on a rototiller? And the problem was, is I was always looking at this manual and saying, okay, step one, and then I was doing step one. Step two, and then I would do step two. Step three, I would do step three. Okay. I put the manual aside and said, okay, now, how does this thing work? How does this, what makes this belt turn and what makes it get loose and how can I adjust it so it works? Okay. And it took me a little bit longer than it would have with the manual right there, but now I know how to adjust the belt. Okay. And I don't have to go back to the manual. My experience taught me more than this manual did in over a period of years. For 4.5 years, I never knew how to fix it because I was always going to the manual. But with the experience of actually doing it, and not following step by step and chopping it up, then I had a sense of learning. Okay? And that's what participation means. It gives you the experience that helps you to learn. When you really make lasting improvements, you both give and receive support. Okay? If you only receive support, it creates an unequal, unempowering relationship. Okay? It confirms our feeling of inadequacy and dependency. So in a lot of ways, giving support is more important than receiving it. Except if you never receive any support, then that becomes very important too. So there's a balance here. Okay? But giving the opportunity for people to give to each other, and that's one of the things that the Hard Times Dollars economy does, is there's an exchange system. Okay? And anyone can exchange Hard Times Dollars with anyone else. You give them, you can take them. Both agree, and there's a system where you can do that. And that is such an empowering thing, because if you've really been in poverty for a long time and you don't have anything, it's hard to give to other people. But it gives you an opportunity to give to other people, and you recognize what strength that gives you. And you recognize that you can have an impact on someone's life becoming better. So we discover our strengths when we give support. Okay, it raises our status, it raises our self-esteem, we become a helper. Okay, and there's actually a lot of research to support this. There's a guy named Reisman at New York University who's really done a lot of writing and research about the self-help movement and found that when people are in a helping role, they learn much more and improve much quicker than when just in a receiving role. Okay, that's well established and very well known at this point. So giving and receiving support, doing both, builds trust and it builds cooperation. Okay? We make contact, we make connections with other people, we become a part of something when we do that. That's what any organization does, any church that you belong to, you give and receive support, any social club you belong to, any community agency that you get involved with. Okay? Join the Lions Club, join the Kiwanis, join the Women's Club. Any of those things, what they do is give and receive support. That's how you build community, is through giving and receiving support. Okay? And again, much of that happens. The Hard Times Cafe, it's just a natural thing. When people come together, that happens. It's just part of being human. Okay? And when we give and receive your support, we begin to rely on internal resources rather than wait for some outside grant. Okay, well, let's go lobby Lansing and see if we can get some money in Clark County so we can provide some jobs for these people. Okay? Well, we could be lobbying from now until who knows when, and we might get a little bit of money in, but the next election, it could change again. Okay, or the next recession, it's certainly going to change. Okay? But if we can help people to rely on their own resources, we're not dependent on that outside stuff. Okay? That's one of the reasons we really want to start a business. Okay? So self-determination replaces dependency and apathy. You get a sense that you're in charge. Okay? Communication and commitment replaces isolation and attachment. You're connected with people. And you make a commitment to each other, you help each other out. Okay, make decisions, the next step. The first words I said at the first meeting that we had that came to me as I was reflecting on where people were was, everything starts with a decision. If you think of anything important that's ever happened in this world, it started with a decision. Someone saying, I'm going to do that, or I'm going to let that happen. Okay? So you have to be able to make decisions. It's the essence of control. Recognizing what your choices are and what decisions you can make. Okay? And it can start out with little decisions, but it builds to big decisions. And if you take away the little decisions, you immobilize someone or get in their way of making the bigger decisions. Okay? If it doesn't matter what you decide, we stop thinking about what our choices are. We stop paying attention to it. We stop planning. We stop building for the future. Get more and more focused in the moment, which can be appropriate sometimes, but if we get stuck there, then we don't ever go anywhere. Every time we make a decision for another person, we can weaken. There's strong potential to weaken. Leading people out of that decision-making process communicates to them that we don't trust their judgment. We don't have confidence in their ability to decide what's best for them. Well, I need to decide this because I know. Okay, that will diminish you. And the way we learn is by experiencing the consequences of our decisions. Okay, I'm going to try this. Whoa, that didn't work. Now, how is it that that didn't work? Oh, that was in the way. Okay, well, I'll move that over there. I'll do it this way. And yeah, that works. Okay, that's how we learn. We make decisions, and we move on then. Okay? We plan. We organize. We learn to figure out what went wrong. We learn from our experience. Okay, so the essence of empowerment of the whole thing is right in there. People don't have the ability to make decisions. They don't have any control. They don't have any power. Okay, work. The Pope was in the United States a number of years ago and said something that really stuck with me. He said that people need work more than they need income. I really believe that that's true. That if you're not working, if you don't have a sense of contributing something, we are a social being, and it's a very human enterprise to work. Okay, in a lot of ways, work defines who we are. People say, "What do you do?" Okay, or "Who are you?" And many of us will answer, "You know, this is my profession. I'm a bricklayer. I'm a carpenter." Okay, and that defines who we are. Okay, being productive and contributing to our community gives us a sense of importance, gives us a sense that we belong, and we're connected. If we don't have any opportunity to do that, then we're kind of living off everyone else, okay, and that diminishes us. Work gives us energy and it gives us satisfaction. You look at it, you feel good. Okay, our patrons can drive by US 27 in the summertime and see those flowers spread out in the median, and they feel good. You can see that. You can see the flowers in front of the post office, and they feel good. I have plants. They're looking good. How we work is more important than the kind of work we do. Okay, and there can be work that saps our energy. And that's generally work that doesn't include any choices or that diminishes our dignity in some way. Okay, so if someone's saying, "You have to do this," or "I'm going to punish you in some way," that's diminishing. That kind of work isn't what I'm talking about here. It has nothing to do with the process of improvement. You can force everybody, and it sounds like, you know, everyone is trying to do that, force everybody to work in whatever job you force them to take, and they can't quit, and if they quit, they lose all of their benefits, and it doesn't matter how they're treated, they don't have any of the rights of the other worker. This is the federal welfare proposal, I'm paraphrasing here. That is not going to lead to empowerment. Okay, that's going to lead to people giving up and moving out of the system. Okay, because ultimately, it takes so much in losing their dignity, and justice, the sense of injustice overwhelms you and just seems not worth it. Okay. Work is different than servitude. It's different than slavery. Okay. Even some people in those situations, though, have had good feelings from their work. The Russian author, Solzhenitsyn, wrote about working in work camps, okay, in the Soviet Union, the prison camp, okay, and the satisfaction they got from the building, and they still had some production. Actually, they had some control over that, and they looked at it. So you need a sense that you're accomplishing something with your work, and not that you're just serving someone else, okay, that you're building something. So they can see a building, and it would go up, and, you know, then they might move into it and live there, and okay, build their barracks and things like that. Without these other steps, work can become a penalty. Okay, and forced work feels like slavery. Obviously. Succeed. If you're going to continue to improve, you need some sense of success. Okay? It's accomplishing, so let me give you a little different definition of success than what we're used to in this culture. Success is accomplishing what's important to you. Success is doing what's most important to you. Now, a lot of times our culture defines what's important, what should be important to it. It should be important to make a lot of money. It should be important to have a big house. It should be important to have a lot of friends. All of these things. It should be important to have this kind of car. It should be important to wear the right clothes. Okay? A lot of those messages come from us through advertising, through the mass culture. But it's up to each one of us to decide what's important to us. Okay? And if we make that decision about what's important to us, then when we're doing that, we can succeed. Okay? Failure is the opposite of success. And I'll give you another definition. Failure. Failure results when we try to do something when we're not ready to do it. We do something before we're ready to do it. Okay? takes away some of the personal connotation of being a personal therapy. Because we're all ready to be human, because we're already arguing. So there's no such thing as a personal therapy. You fail, it's something that you attempt to do, and if you fail at it, it means you're okay. So then you can move with that. You can look at, okay, how was it that I wasn't ready? Okay. Now, success, like responsibility and opportunity, needs to fit where the person is. And sometimes you need to have some small successes that you can build on. Okay? Sometimes a small success to one person may be a big success to another person. Okay? Simply speaking up in a meeting can be a very big success for some people. Okay? And then they start taking it for granted because they do it all the time. And in recognizing and acknowledging and identifying those successes, because all of this is based on perception. So if you don't perceive that you're succeeding, okay, and there are tons of people who have done this. I mean, people who are significantly depressed have even committed suicide, you know, who have all of the trappings of success. You know, maybe they've won the lottery, or they're in charge of their company, or they've gotten the promotion, and they've gotten their new car, and they've got everything they want, but internally they feel empty. Okay, so it's how you perceive your success, and that depends on how you choose what's important to you. Frustration and discouragement can block out our perception of success. Okay? So we need to recognize those small accomplishments that can build up the confidence so we can keep moving. Because that's what gives us motivation. The small successes give us the motivation to keep on moving and to keep on growing. And then the top step, and it invariably happens when people continue to improve, you recognize your essential humanness, our essential dependency and connectedness with each other, and you share your improvements with other people. And that's one of the beautiful things about the Hard Times Cafe. There's a number of people who've gotten full-time jobs and continue to come back and share their success. And one of the first things we do at every meeting is to recognize people who've gotten jobs and gone back to school so that they have that sense of recognition, and that they've been encouraged to share that. So it helps you to realize your improvement and to appreciate that, okay? And to understand also that it's an ongoing process, that you don't just say, okay, now I've improved and I'm done, okay? Because there's always something to do. And as you share, you recognize that there are other goals that you can make, other things that you can work on. So there needs to be opportunities and incentives for people to share their progress so they feel connected with the improvement process. Otherwise, the improvement stops. Okay, if you're not sharing that and going on, then it's no longer a process, it's an endpoint, and then you're not improving anymore. And confidence and self-esteem get an added boost as you share your success with other people, because then you recognize what you're saying. Okay? So that's the complete picture in terms of all of the steps and the four principles that are supported by those steps, and to some extent, how they intermingle together. And it's 3 minutes after 12. We can take some clarifying questions. And as soon as they're done, we'll eat lunch. And then we come back for an hour between 1 and 2. And I think for that session, we'll just have like an open discussion about anything here. But in particular, some of the things we were talking about earlier, it sounds like we need some follow-up, is how do you make this work in your own setting? Okay. How does this need to, how can this be made to fit in what you do or what you would like to do where you are? Are there any clarifying questions before we close for our break? Okay, lunch is in the same place yesterday, and we'll see you back here at 1 o'clock.
Nobody's here. Everybody's having their own conversation.
Well, I guess that's okay. That's not as good as okay, we've got just under an hour remaining, and we'd like to first of all answer any questions that you have, but also if you could figure out how this model and these four principles on these steps can fit with your unique situation. Okay, they're growing out of our experience with Hard Times Cafe and my experience in working with disadvantaged people, but how can we make that fit? Because every situation is different, and what we really believe is that this can fit in a variety of settings, and that the basic theory and philosophy fits in clarifying questions or anything about any of these sets of steps. This is basically everything we've talked about so far, with the exception of the ABCs, and they're kind of, they're underneath here, behind there. But, so it's a quick way to get at any situation. Yes?
One thing I want to make sure I ask before we left is, like, you know, with your role in this, are you kind of unique as far as your views on empowerment, or are we likely to find other therapists or whatever in our community that and know a little bit about empowerment? You know, I guess that's my, if you're kind of a unique individual here, and that's why it started in clear.
Well, unique is a much nicer word than weird, so.
But, you know, I can talk, I know a lot of counselors and therapists and whatnot, so I can see what their interest is, or their experience is.
I haven't really gotten into the literature, so I don't know the state of the art in empowerment based on experience. So it's experience across a range of settings. So it's with retarded people, it's with chronically mentally ill people, it's with people coming into counseling, it's with part-time cafe patrons, chronically ill people, chronic pain, panic attacks. It's across a wide range of situations. So my sense is that it can apply in a number of situations, but I really don't have I just don't have time to do much reading. I guess you were saying, Michael, that there's not a lot of development in terms of theory of empowerment.
There's very, very little written about empowerment.
Yeah. I do. I got a hold of one article that, you know, had a bunch of different definitions for it. To me, it's the best definitions to write out of the dictionary. I always find it confusing when someone acronym defines one word in a different way than everyone else defines it. Then you wind up having an exclusion thing. You have to have this training to know what this word means. And so I see there's a real value in using words that are accepts. So basically, it's just a sum of what's worked for me and what's been missing when it hasn't worked. And that's how it was developed in hindsight. And we had a conference a couple years ago, and something one way to present triggered out this system.
I think, though, that what Jay is asking is about your uniqueness. And I think if you're going to be looking for somebody to get work or buy into this, you need to look at somebody that really likes to work with the client population. You know, you can't find somebody that's got a private practice over here that's billing insurance. They're probably not going to work out. So, and I think that's real important when you're looking at the people that you're going to
find. Yeah. Someone who's empowering people, and my guess is that they're using some of these concepts. That's what works for us.
Our person that fit this is going to Australia, so we don't know if she's coming back.
Oh, no.
Well, she's resigned her position. No one else.
It's part of the price of being
unique. I guess.
Other thoughts? Yes.
I was just curious. What do you think motivated you to come up with this? Was it your circumstances of losing your job and looking at what's out there, or
I had a job
before?
Your
mental health. I assume you worked for Department of Mental
Health.
Oh, you came up with Hard Times Cafe. What motivated the evolving of that?
In myself?
Right.
Have you heard of a program similar to this?
Well, the Fairweather program really started thinking about it, and that was my hope, to try to duplicate something like that for the population. I think a lot of this is just knowing what it's like to go through hard times, and that I've lost everything myself. And I could say at that first meeting, you know, there were three times in my life when I lost my last dollar. Twice I handled it well, and once I didn't handle it well, not at all. And here's what I did when I did handle it well. So, you know, and so I think having been
think just a lifelong commitment to learn from experience. It's just part of somehow connected with you somehow that that's what life is about, is to learn from our experience. And that there's always that as a teacher, and our reason for living is to continue to improve and to serve. It's just an ongoing process. So, I mean, we didn't start out to, you know, set up this organization for what it's become right now. We started off to respond to an immediate need that was coming up. It's just a sense that I think both Gretchen and I have is that there's a crisis here and nobody's doing anything about it. And so let's try something. And so we just took two steps and we tried something, and then each time responded to where they were. They needed some immediate incentives, so we set up the hard time dollars system where they earn points at the meetings, and we set up the store. And we talked about some goals, and people needed to work and to feel productive, so we set up a community service work system. It was an interactive process. It wasn't like I was sitting up in a tower somewhere, you know, or under a tree waiting for an apple to fall or something to give me enlightenment to figure out how it did. Without the patrons at the meeting every step of the way, you know, very little of this would have gotten done. Some concepts based on the Fairweather thing, and I always thought that people needed to work, and that people, it should feel good when you work, and people need a sense of control over those lives. That was something I just learned real early. The extent that you do keep the control, they improve. So that's something that I'm always trying to do, but the development and the systems and all of that was just totally incremental, one step at a time. And I think that's one big problem that we've run into as professionals, and the way our agencies are structured and our guidelines are structured, is we're totally focused on goals. Okay, and that's what the new welfare system is supposed to do, is everybody's supposed to, the first day come in and set a goal for what you want to accomplish. We're all goal-oriented. And really, I think with the people who were experienced being disadvantaged or being in poverty, an incremental approach makes a lot more sense. So that you set a direction rather than a goal. Okay? We're focused on measurable objectives. Okay, we've got to measure how this works. Okay, and I really think it's much more effective to have a direction rather than an objective. An objective is objects, okay? It's things, okay? People are not objects, okay? People move in directions and they get momentum and things like that. Objects can be measured. People can't really be measured. You can count what they do and observe what they do. But you miss something if that's your primary focus. So the real key is human to human. And as I'm talking, where I really learned that was working with profoundly retarded people. I mean, they taught me my clinical skills. I learned more from a single probably retired person than I did from any of the professors I've ever had college courses from or taken seminars from. Basically, I worked with one guy who was totally withdrawn. His eyes were closed, and he closed up like this, and he just started beating his head on the wall. And he'd been doing that for years. He hadn't opened his eyes in a number of years. And just establishing a relationship with him, just going hanging out with him for 15, 20 minutes a day. I told him to stop his feet and hit his head because I knew he was tensing up instead of discharging down. And within a few weeks, he just opened up. And his eyes opened and he started talking again. And he kissed his mother when she came to visit. She used to visit him every month. And he would spit at her and never look at her or do anything like that. He just opened up. But when I was with him, if I was distracted, I paid big time. He spit in my face. He clawed at me. You know, if I was in a hurry, and I remember one time I had to go to a meeting, and someone said, he's refusing his medication. Can you get him to take his medication? And usually they didn't cooperate. They're having trouble because they have a good relationship. But I had this meeting to go to, so I had 5 minutes for him to take his medication. I wound up staying an hour and a half there. Okay? And I finally had to walk away because I was ready to clobber. Okay? I mean, he just knew how to push my buttons and was pushing them one after another, and I stuck with it, and I finally said, I've got to walk away. And I went and cooled off and came back, and then I realized that I was trying to control that situation. Okay? And when I could
and feel where he was coming from, we could relate. But if I ever didn't do that, he let me have it. Just getting right in my face. He had a big wad. Bring up more fun than you can imagine, right in my face. Really. You got to walk away when somebody does that. But that was invaluable training, okay, because I can get a sense of when I need what I need to do that. And he taught me that when I'm out of touch, I'm way out of touch. Okay, so that's a good experience. And I think that's a real key to this kind of work, is that we're always learning, and our best teachers are our most difficult struggles. And there's something in there, anytime we're struggling with something in there that we need to learn. Okay, so we look at those not as stressors, not as a pain in the behind, but as a challenging course. Okay, a challenging learning experience, something that we really need to pick up on and look at and understand. Okay, so it's still a question of reframing and changing perceptions. So this intervention, do you have any comments on all this?
Well, from the emergency, that's the idea. But it's true, everything that, how it evolved was from what the patrons. And I'm thinking today is the first day in Benzie County that they're going to have their first meeting, and it's after, you know, this concept. And one of the things I was talking to Chloe about, and we were talking about, and I think it's real important to have to keep reminding yourself, because she was saying how they had set things up and they had structured things, and they do have clients that are helping them with doing this. But I said, well, you know, don't forget, you know, that those people at that meeting are the ones that are going to decide whether you're going to continue with that structure. They're the ones that are going to be in control and make the decision. So I think that's the success of Part-Time Campaign, is that they feel like, and they know that they're the ones that are doing, are making the final decision, and they have the control. And it's real easy as an agency person to forget that. It's really easy to just go in and kind of say, we're going to do this, we're going to do that, without saying, we want to do this.
Yeah.
And I think that's what has kept it going. And we've had our hard times to pay us that hard time. But I think when we go back to remembering that it's everybody's decision on what direction we're going to go in.
I think another key is not being attached. And I've learned this working with clients. If I get a client in and I get an investment, somehow, I mean, if all of my clients touch me, I'm not going to be affected. I need to be moved in a sense by their situation. But if I get hooked and I get an investment in this person improving in some way or getting together or saving a relationship or something like that, these two people just really need to work it out. Okay, and thinking of the situation where I get into that, these people just really trying real hard and then really need to work it out. Okay. Anytime I'm hooked that I have an investment in something improving in a certain way or something happening, I recognize that my ego is what's operating in this movie up here that I'm creating of what I think should be rather than working human to human. Okay? And so it's basic respect, I think, that you respect people's right to stay in their misery and to be where they are until they choose to change. And any time that I've tried to push or make something happen, it's blown up in my face. I think I'm unfortunate in that respect. Because it just doesn't work. So you can see someone who's got a lot of potential and, oh yeah, I want them to be this coordinator in this time, back off, okay? Because they're gonna go in their direction. And to the extent I set a direction for that, they're going to get in my face at some point. They're going to rebel against that. That's a healthy thing for them to do. So to not be attached. You do what needs to be done based on what you believe, and you have faith in that. So I believe in these concepts and these steps and these principles, and so I try as much as possible to live that and be in the moment of each situation and not look on it, reflect on it, or look at what should be, or to hope for someone or anything like that. I think when you have too high hopes for someone, you diminish their dignity. And that may
sound like a contradiction, but I personally don't find this diminish someone's dignity by having too high hopes for them and set them up. And you can push them, if you make someone do something a couple minutes before they're ready to do it, okay, it's a question of choosing that yourself and not feeling that pressure as we respond to that pressure, and particularly if you're feeling vulnerable. Undo a lot of things by letting people be. And so it can be frustrating. And if somebody comes and sits and takes a free meal from you, there's a guy who's been taking a free meal for probably a year and a half. He finally came to a meeting last month. Okay? And found out he's got some real skills. He's got some experience in dealing with the legal system, and he's helped out people in getting their SSI when they've been turned down. And you know, we'll figure out a spot for him. But he hung out and was the first one out the door after he finished dinner for a year and a half. And he finally came to a meeting. Right? Never put any pressure on him. So, you know, it's easy to let that frustration drive you. Okay? And it's easy to find negatives. Okay? And if you really want to look for negatives at the Hard Times Cafe, you know, you're going to need a truck to haul them all. If you're writing down. You need a truck to haul them out with you, okay? I mean, you can always find something wrong, and as we're talking lunch, that's simple, and in a way, it's cheap, okay? Because we're human, okay? By definition, you can find something negative about anyone in here, and you can spend the rest of this session finding something negative about any one person and confirming it off, okay? It doesn't do me any good whatsoever. The trick is to let go of that, okay? So it's also a process of letting go. Very much so, processing and go. And then starting again, okay, and building on those principles and those steps, and letting go of our impulse, and building on those principles and steps. And then not letting go of the impulse, and messing up, and then learning in hindsight, then letting go, building on the principles and steps. Okay, it's not like you ever have it all together.
One of the things that happened for Bob and I when we first started the people that came to Hard Times at the time, I mean, I was DSS and we were GA being cut off. And so I think they were looking at us and kind of judging us. And I don't know if Bob's told this story, but we messed up one time. And when Bob was able to get up and say, you know, this was wrong, I apologize and I made a mistake, was when they really started to trust. And I think that it's real important to be honest, because we all mess up at one time or another, just like everybody else. So to be really honest with them, you know, then you can develop that and move forward.
And to have a kind of filter, it's almost like a sieve, okay, where everything flows through and you keep out just the little kernel that you're trying to do. You look for the gold in every remark. Okay, so somebody's in your face and telling you how stupid you are. Okay, you're looking for gold in there. Okay, and that does two things. For one thing, it takes your mind away from all of the mud that's coming at you. Okay, it's just going through. That goes past, and you don't grab onto it, because if you grabbed onto that mud and really looked at it, you know, you could give up right there, or you'd start throwing it back. Okay. So it distracts you from that, but it also helps you to find the goal. And someone who's in your face has a point about something. And if you can give them credit for that and recognize the goal within that, they'll start to see it within themselves. Okay, so it's being able to sort through that. And that isn't something you just do automatically. Again, the easiest way to learn is hindsight. Okay, this person was in my face and I told them to screw off. Okay, well, what else could I have done? And so you just sort through it, and you think, well, if I had done this, then yeah, that might work. Now, where was their point? Okay, where can I give some legitimacy? Where can I really respond, you know, down to earth? Okay, and again, that's going to require balance. To the extent that you're out of balance, that's tough. You need to be able to do that processing, and it's simply a skill that always grows and develops, and that you choose to do. It becomes easier the more you do it, as long as.
thoughts about what would be some obstacles to making this happen in your own community, in your own sector, in a way?
Over-planning.
Over-planning, yes.
With professionals.
Yes.
I digress, you know, it's like, shorter the planning process, the better your chances for success.
Yeah. We didn't have a staff meeting until we've been open for almost 3 months. People would be appalled. But I think that got us off to a nice, healthy start. Yeah, over-planning is a real potential. Gretchen and I were on a task force, statewide task force, looking at the social contract. And there was a group out of Kalamazoo that spent thousands upon thousands of dollars and lots of staff time devising this beautiful program. And they had this wonderful manual that had a hardcover manual and all kinds of curriculums and things like that for people to climb out of poverty and take these classes. And just a really nice, neat system. And then they opened it up and no one came. No disadvantaged people showed up. Okay? They left them out of the process. They had a real nice theoretical thing and did lots of research and went to the library and talked to professors and experts and got all kinds of great stuff. But no disadvantaged people came to take advantage.
Yes. You mentioned the first meeting that you just kind of got together with some people about planning the dinner. What about the next week? Did you have resources lined up for that? Like how long before you could stop worrying about where your food was going to come from?
Can we stop worrying yet?
No.
But like after the first week,
well, you just keep hitting up different
well,
resources.
We had a commitment
from our social services board from November through December to provide for the meal.
Yeah. Okay.
A commitment for
yeah.
that. But we were talking about, you know, like how many people, 18 or 35 to, we had an average of 25 or so each meeting. It wasn't like, you know, hundreds or anything, but we had a commitment. But we had to worry after that. We had to figure out another way to provide for the meal. And most of the time it's through donations. Now we are a regular recipient of crop walk money. We do get that on a yearly basis. And we have also been able to, we haven't really done this yet. There have been a few problems with that. But there is some emergency services money through the county that they are going to be able to help us with that, a certain amount per person. But they have to be people that are already on the rolls. And so, and not everybody that comes to Hartford Tech Day is getting some services from DSS.
There's an interesting story behind that decision because you can run the names, the sign-up sheet through the DSS computer and pick out the ones and then you pay for that. That was the offer that we had. But that had to be approved by the patrons. And one person said, I'm not ready to vote on this. I want to play it for a week. Okay? That cost us $100 in income, but that person has the authority to do that. Any one person can delay the process. And nobody got on her case for that. Okay? Because everybody respects that. And I kind of expected this. She might get some flack for that, but people respected that. Okay, it cost us $100, but her having that say-so and having the time to think about it and pass unanimously the next week is okay, because that's more important. People having that sense of authority that they're in control of the process is more important than the money that you get into the program. Those priorities are real.
It's probably pointed more towards DeWayne. Working with Head Start and Share and neighbors, what would be a tactful way to recognize someone's inability to read or fill out all these forms? After I've picked up on these people, they give me the impression, had I been willing to do the forms for them, then they would have been a little more active. And the three people I'm thinking of, I was never offensive, and I filled out the forms for them, and they were forward enough to tell me that they had a problem, they couldn't read. But is there any way to take and see that tactfully to, like you know, Bob said, not hand you the paper and hand it turn away?
kind of a difficult question.
The only thing, like he's always had, if you notice, he'll always have somebody else do everything as far as if any reading. Different meetings or things we've been to, if something is laid in front of him, he'll push it to me. Or whoever happens to be with him that knows that he can't read and write it. You just have to kind of watch.
Recognizing the ghost.
The deal is, I go through the, oh, I don't care if I read or not. That's the attitude I have. I ain't interested in reading. I'm interested in other stuff. I got one handicap. But everybody's got a handicap, so. You sure is? There's times I wish I could read that. Because there's a lot of things holding me back. Like, I know a lot about cars, but I can't go get my mechanic license because you gotta learn how to do all that. Nowadays, that's the way it is. But back in the 70s and the 60s, you didn't need to read. You worked with your hand, that's all you need to do. Nowadays, it's getting harder.
And the schools didn't enforce the learning like they do now. I don't know that they just split them through.
See, it seems to me, a person is like a product, a car or something. That car comes out of the factory, something wrong with it. Seems to me they've got to take the car back and redo it. I had one teacher, she did teach me quite a bit, and she said it over and over again until I get it right. It's a lot of teachers to me, they give you a piece of paper, there you go, I'll do it. I don't know how to do that. You got to explain it to me a time before I get it through my head. But it's like a lot of my, on my side of family, the, I don't know, a lot of us can't read the way we were brought up, I guess. My mom and dad, he went to school, but their education was on high either. And I guess it goes through generations, I guess.
Sensitive to the body. And this is what this means rather than reading it with the word. This part says this. Okay. I can do the writing if you don't have me to do it. You can do it by direct conversation.
Can you bring up a good point about being sensitive to body language? Because one of the things is the people at hard times. Very sensitive body language. And so we as people who are there as volunteers or agency people have to really be very honest about our body language. And they pick up on us a lot faster sometimes than I pick up on them. And they read body language very well.
To see the contradiction.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And the worst thing is if they don't call you on it. Okay. And I think we're fortunate that some. Most of the patrons will call us on stuff now. We're saying something because it seems sincere. Nobody else will jump on me and wait a minute, okay? And give me a pattern, we can catch it right away. Someone can catch it. Okay? reinforces that concept that openness is the only way to do it. Anytime you try to hide something, it's going to snowball and reinforce it. You try to pretend that you know what you're doing, and it soon becomes clear that you're less than more productive. It backfires. Short-term gain, long-term income cost. Okay?
Well, the thing I think about hard time is the best thing I fear would ever happen. Last year, I don't think anybody could come up with some of the things that God has been working with. I think they not just worked with themselves, but God was with them. At least, I can say one thing. If I was hard time, I had never seen anybody criticize handicapped people for any reason, whatever they feel, how they can say, or whatever. I think they prompt each one is getting ready to do certain things, like what I'm doing right now. I'm proud of what I am. My stepmother might feel different. But I don't criticize it. I try to give the courage saying, listen, if you want me to be something, let me do it. If you criticize me, it's like putting that aside. That means nothing. I can give up. But I didn't. I kept on going. That's why I like about conference, because I learned from you people, and I think you people learn from us. No matter what you find, where we can read and write. I can write. Think of this, if I handed a paper, would you be able to understand it? You might, if she takes your time. If she doesn't care, she has no way back. But she can take it to look at it and think what you think. If there's something misspelled, she'll understand it. It's up there what everybody thinks in their time. But I'm proud of what I am. I think each one of us all are proud. We are improving ourselves by what we're doing here today. And that's the way I feel.
Happy
to.
Most jobs, like filling out an application, you know. Well, like me, I will try to fill it out. Might look sloppy. But they'll take that application, most likely they'll throw it away. They don't know that person until they give them a try. That's why most of the public, they got to start looking at handicapped people. It doesn't have to be handicapped. You got to look at each person. That's what hard times do. They look at people, not, you know, anybody look like they've got sloppy clothes. That don't mean they're no good. There's other points. He is good. They'll find something in that guy or gal. There's something good about him. Just like alcoholics and drugs. It might be as a bad thing what they're doing, but in time they probably figure out a way to get out of it. Just don't judge a person right then now. Wait until he works in it. You find out a lot of times it'll work out all right.
I think it's something that they both have brought up and that you confirmed, Dwayne, and it's a real important part of this. Pat said it in terms of that God works with us, okay, and I don't think it matters what your religious belief is. The bottom line, for that to happen, you have to let go. Out of the way. You have to get your own ego out of the way, your own beliefs out of the way, because it's going to take you in a direction. And I think that this is ultimately a natural process. And if you let go of all of the stuff that gets in the way, this really is natural. And if you let go of your judgment about how someone writes or how they look, and let go of all your preconceptions, you're going to find the beauty in that person. You're going to find the strengths in it. Like you have to make this happen or work at it. The big work is in getting out of the way and letting go and letting it happen. And the big work is unlearning what we think should be and reacting to what is. Okay, so it's more not doing in a sense than it is doing. Yes?
I was just going to say that I understand your question, though, because I've had a situation very similar where, you know, the woman did not know how to read. And I didn't pick up on it, but how do you not destroy their dignity by saying, well, can I help make it out? You know what I mean? Just in that, in
offering your help, you're saying you're not capable of doing it. And I don't like that feeling. So rather than even confronting and being open, then what do? I mean, you're going to ignore it and say, well, she can't read. Or you're going to say something that's going to be demeaning, which is not even meant to be demeaning, but I don't know how you get away from that. I mean, because this was very important for these things to be made out. So, in order for her to get the help that she needed.
I'm going to point to this, and I think Tina's got a response to what you're saying.
I believe anytime you ask anybody if they need help, I don't believe it's demeaning them. Even if I could, if you asked me, you know, if you handed me a piece of paper and said, is there, you don't even have to say, can I read it to you? Just say something along the lines of, maybe you'd like me to explain it. That way, instead of going word for word, I mean, we do paperwork all the time. We help people fill out paperwork. Instead of reading word for word, I'll summarize it. That way, it doesn't seem like I'm reading it to them. Maybe they can't read. You know, most of the people that come in, we know they can't read. That's why they're asking for our help. But instead of making it seem like, you know, like we're doing them a favor, we make it seem like they're doing us a favor. A lot of times I'll say, oh, gee, I need the practice. Do you mind if I read this to you? Because, you know, sometimes we have people that come in here, they can't do it. So I need the practice. They'll say, sure. You know, sometimes, you know, they'll say, well, maybe they don't know. Or sometimes they'll say, well, I can't read it. It would be really nice if you would do that for me. You know, you might need the practice, but I need to know what it says. There are many tactful ways of saying, can I help you, without saying, you can't do it, let me do it for you. It's real easy to go up to somebody and say, oh, I noticed you can't read that, can I do it for you? And then, you know, you can go up and say, well, I noticed this, you know, you have a funny look on your face, do you not understand what you're saying? You know, maybe I can answer a question, do you have a question about what you're reading? And that way they can ask a question without without sounding stupid or without letting you know that they can't read.
And as you get more practice in clarifying, you can choose the words that fit it. So instead of saying, it seems like you can't read this, you can say, it seems like this might be difficult to understand. Okay? So that's the clearer term, because that's what's difficult to understand. I could put something else in front of him that he would be able to understand. And you can put something in front of me that I wouldn't be able to understand.
Or you
depends
could,
on
or
that
you could
situation.
Make it a group thing.
So we always use a neutral.
You could, you could make it a group thing. I realize that this paper is very difficult to understand. We have lots of people that come in here that don't understand it. So if you have any questions, feel free to ask. Say at the beginning, you know, if you suspect, like you said, if you hand somebody the paper and they look at you really strange, then have something prepared. Oh, we realized that, you know, the people who wrote this didn't write it to be understood. So if you have any questions or if you'd like me to it's real easy to make somebody feel like they're doing you a favor by letting you help them.
And the bottom line is that's the truth. Because depending on how you look at it, either I don't say it clearly or they don't understand it, but both are happening. Okay, if someone doesn't understand it, I haven't said it clearly in a way where I've really listened to where they're at and understand their position. So if I phrase that, well, I probably didn't say that very clearly, let me try again. Let me hear how you did it. The worst option that you suggested was to try to cover it up and try to hide it and pick it up like that. Okay? And people who are disadvantaged or handicapped will pick it up quicker than any professional. Okay? Because professionals are in their heads, and you can put stuff over on them, and we're used to relating to sound bites and to information. Whereas disadvantaged people are more into their bodies and are going to pick up on those messages much quicker. And you can't put it over on them. They'll just put up a mask so you won't know the difference. Okay, and they'll think you're doing a good job. Yes, thank you very much.
Okay.
There you go. Yes.
With registration for share, I could use the tactic that picking up on the fact that possibly senior citizens eye problems, glasses, and I go, oh, well, maybe it's too fine a print. Could I read it to you? Something like that. That helped for the one, well, two instances.
Yeah. Well, I think we're going to have an answer to that one. But the thing with this, even if you turn the application into someone and don't look at it, The doctors here, what kind of patients do they have? You know, you got a lot of work to do, you got a lot to pull out. If one was a good one, another one was a handicap, which one of these are you going to look at first? If the handicap first got running and they're trying to make a clear so they can get something, you look over there, there's, and you're going to look. I guess what I'm trying to say is trying to say so many, how much time are you giving yourself to look at the handicap and compare to a good person that might have a better ability, new schools and stuff like that? Maybe there's reasons why some handicapped can't get through schools because of their understanding. They need more training and qualification. By the time they get done what they're doing, the good person will have a better job. The handicapped is still left behind waiting on waiting there. There isn't much work out there for handicapped. I think that's why I'm also in a hard time of them four categories. It's like the Ten Commandments. You follow God's Ten Commandments, you keep yourself safe, you know where you're going. It's almost similar to that. That is a little more different because that one is saying, well, are you willing to keep working with it? Or are you going to give up? Or are you going to try? Whichever way it is. That's another reason I say it's, we all have hard decisions to make. I don't care if we're handicapped or normal or whatever. Sometimes Bob even has some difficulty of understanding that sometimes even us handicapped can open up with him. Like me, I can open up with him where nobody else kind of put it. Because I study out of it because I listen to him. At home, I'm a little different. Sometimes I don't listen to half the thing goes on at home to what you're doing here. But I feel it's more important to hear what goes on here than what you worry about at home. Because, you know, normally homework like that, normally it's a different subject to what you do. I did a handicap, like Bob said, about is what they pick up right away. Some things I can pick up. I do have a hard time of hearing. Sometimes I have to have them repeat it in order to pick up the way, because my thinking is still working now. So I think that clarifies myself in a way, I think.
Anyone believe that Pat wouldn't say a word for the first month he came in our guest?
Well, if I can't do a job, Bob, they always say, it's no good for you if you can't do your job.
It's your father's job, you should.
Right.
Our heart trainers campaign, you could say it was Beaton Field Rehabilitation Center. Everybody that comes in with a problem, we help out. Do that stuff. If we keep it to ourselves, we don't want to have that problem, and we're going to keep building up on it. If they let us know, and we let the other patrons know, we help them out. We're just bummed that somebody in there had the same problem back in the past. That can show them the way out.
See, that happens spontaneously. That's not like when you built in or planned. That's part of nature. You bring people together and you focus on their strengths, and that grows and develops. We've got about 5 minutes left. Are there any last comments or questions or particularly thoughts about your own situation? How could you make this work better? What would you need to let go of?
Get this. You know, a lot of people don't like to do that. want it for free, but they don't want to admit that they need it either.
And don't make them do it. Don't do it themselves. Don't tell them, well, you got to do this. Well, no, I won't. You can tell me what to do.
They have to come back to the next meeting, when they're ready, they'll come back.
They go on their own, they'll see 1 week, maybe that ain't for me, or maybe it is, I'll come back next week, do it all over again. That's what it is, it's careful people, that's all it takes. And hard time to work, you just give it a try.
And the authority figure scares them. You got to be able to show that you're at their level, not I'm higher than you, you got to do as I say, or, you know. Because I think everybody's afraid of their worker.
That's when there's a hard time to get a business. Ingo says Myers, and he says hard times people. You work for, say, Myers, you're working for that guy's name, you got to keep him up. Hard times people working for that business, we're all working for that business. That's what's going to be the difference. People's going to have kind of business to just one guy. That's what it is. People working together. It's all it takes.
What is the other factory in Battle Creek? What do they call themselves?
Battle Creek is in the process of working out a name. There's a program in Alma, actually, that started up first somewhere in Boston, which was taking a different direction. They're called the Community Campaign. I think that Benzie was calling them Services campaign. We hope to as people get into programs, we'd like to keep in communication, and to the extent that we can, we're open to talking to you, especially on the phone. That's very easy. Answering questions and giving feedback and things like that. We've also talked about, being able to send a letter to people, to patrons about the concepts and things like that, and having the communication going. And certainly, our patrons have expressed a willingness to go wherever possible. We might need some help with transportation costs and things like that. But to go down and visit with the potential patrons that you have, I'm a little harder because I've got some limitations with my back and how far I can travel, but with enough notice, and generally I take some vacation time, so the cost is higher there too. But I can do some consulting. Depending on what happens with our finances and my job, I mean, just one consultant. It's going to happen there at the end of the year. But there's a lot of ways that you would like to try to continue to work with you and help you. And if you have any suggestions for us for future conferences, one question for is the two-day format too difficult for people to get away? Because we had like 90 people at our last conference in May, and it was on one day, and the overwhelming feedback we got was maybe 2 days, but now we just got 6 people sign up for 2 days, so we barely covered our costs. So the temptation is to go back for one day. So if you can give us some feedback on that, was it really
important?
In the
one day,
did
they get
we had room for 30 people to come the night before. We held it on a Friday, and so we had the option for people who registered to come the night before. If we had more than 30 people, it would be too crowded for some reason. So not everyone who came to the conference came to the cafe last time. But pretty much, you could show up any Thursday night. As we're getting into winter, it's best to call ahead. It's best to call ahead anyway, because if we have two or three groups coming to visit, we might actually come on another day just so it's not too crowded. And there are times we've had to rewash the silverware, to give everybody a chance to eat things. So if we can anticipate that, we can make sure there's enough food and everything. And you want to make sure that with winter months coming on, because the Harrison School is closed, we close. So you don't drive all the way up to the store and find out they were not having a meeting. But those decisions were made early enough in the day. So it's rare. But it's an open process, so you're welcome to come. If you're coming alone, there's no problem. You can ask them for another person, but if you're bringing, two or three or half a dozen people, it's going to help us let us know, so make sure we got the food.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yes.
The only thing that was different about the last conference is it wasn't quite so open. Not so much that we had more people, just that we were in a hurry to get through everything, so we didn't have as much question and answer time. There wasn't as much feedback.
Basically covered the same material. I didn't think the ABCs very much. Basically, we just went through the same set of steps, but there was less discussion and less chance to personalize.
I think the discussion is helpful to me. I wasn't here first for the one day thing, but the discussion is helpful because, you know, I spent some time since I first talked to you, and it's going, you know, staying at the conference in Grand Rapids and brainstorming some things about, you know, what we could network with and what, you know, what parts of the, what bits and pieces of this we might already have in place we wanted to reinvent, you know, and just kind of, I think this might work well in the county. You know, so I think that part's helpful as far as. Started brainstorming at all. You know, I would be fearful of the one day thing just in the sense that, you know, saying you have a lot of people, you don't have a lot of discussion, you're going to be going away from here with a lot of unanswered questions. I feel pretty satisfied. You know, we've had some feedback from patrons and yourself and Gretchen and other people here for the same reason I am.
What if we did a one day and kind of went through the stuff and got it all covered and then had follow up sessions?
I think as long as you still have the patron participation involved in that, I think that's a good plus.
Is the purpose of the workshop for groups to copy what hard times is going, and if 90 people came last time, there's only two new children, we would pop up. Is that the goal?
We didn't define the purpose to replicate. We defined it as to do training on how to work with disadvantaged people. So we sent out flyers to know how agencies, social service agencies, and churches, anyone who's in a helping role to basically help them become effective. Because we're not ready to. Our thought last spring when we were looking for expanding and we thought there was going to be some funding for staff positions, we don't pay a full-time job.